Our scripture reading this morning is from Psalm chapter 100. I think it's also printed in your bulletin, but if not, it's right here in front of us, Psalm 100. Watch this automatically just jump up there and appear. How about read it with me? Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. The word of God for the people of God. When I was growing up, I remember early on Sunday mornings, some of you would remember perhaps this too, Reverend Oral Roberts. If I said that name, how many would remember that? I remember waking up on Sunday morning. I was just, at this point, I mean, I was just a boy. I'm talking 10, 9, 11, that age range. But I'd wake up early on Sunday morning, and early could have been 7 to 8, I can't remember exactly. And I would go into our den and sit down in the floor right in front of the TV and turn it on, and I would watch Oral Roberts and the Oral Roberts Singers out of Tulsa, Oklahoma. And it just made my day, because I would be going to worship later with my aunt and uncle, who always stopped and picked me up to take me. But during that time, I was able to hear the Oral Roberts Singers. And every Sunday, they came on with the same song. Something good is going to happen to you today. Something good is going to happen to you today. I won't sing it to you. Because Jesus, that wouldn't be good. Because Jesus of Nazareth is passing your way. And then Oral Roberts would come out onto the platform, and he would kind of share those same words. Something good is going to happen to you today. And when we think about worship, that's what I'm always looking for and longing for, is that in worship, something good happens to us when we come and gather in the setting of worship. One of our points that I want to quickly make is about having passionate worship and what it means to have passionate worship. Passionate worship, when you use that term, it means worship that engages us, or a worship setting where the Holy Spirit engages and moves in our hearts and our lives such that we are open and receptive to the move of God. So as we think about worship as the number five step that you guys have been following, and the first point of it simply says, passionate worship provides us with an opportunity to experience God. And even at my young age, as I said earlier, or that period in my life of that young age, I got a little pain right there. Yeah, that's not good. Y'all hold on there for a minute. Maybe it'll go away. At that young age, 8, 9, and 10, it was an interesting thing for passionate worship to be involved in such a way in my own life at that young age that I was excited about being there. Because even though I got to admit I was alone, other than with the Oral Roberts Singers on television and Oral Roberts standing there bringing the word, I was connected with them in a powerful way, because I longed to do that. Every Sunday morning, I had to watch that program and wanted to watch it. But passionate worship provides us with an opportunity to experience God. And that's what we long to have in our lives. It's almost like when we get up on Sunday morning, we want to be able to say, I can't wait to get to church. I can't wait to get there to be with my family of God. I can't wait to get there to see and participate in the music. I can't wait to get there to greet people, to have some coffee with people, to share with people, and then to enter into the worship setting to worship. And something of value will happen there. You can ask my wife, who's been involved with me personally for 30 years in the worship setting, and she can tell you she's heard enough sermons and enough talk by me and others that it's not always beneficial to her. And she's old enough and brave enough now that she'll say, I didn't get much out of the sermon. It's supposed to be funny. I threw the brave in there for my own part. But she's old enough and mature enough, and we are, for her to say, well, you had 14 points instead of 3. You know, you could have had a series out of that one sermon. And she said, but the music, I really got into that today. It was really awesome. Or sometimes, maybe you've been there when John would ask, how do you think this service went? And you get a response that says, well, the music was really good today. We used to have 3 churches that for 8 years, Fran and I was pastoring 3 churches, and when we first started, and it was a 100-mile round trip for 3 years between 3 of those churches for 3 straight years. And Fran went with me many times to all of those services, the 100-mile round trip from home back to home, 3 different services each Sunday morning. Sometimes even when she was 8 months pregnant, she would go. And in between the churches, when we'd leave one headed to another, she'd say, why don't you leave this part out? Why don't you put this part in? And people even to this day at the bypass campus, when they leave, they'll say to Fran, God, you wrote a good one this week, Fran. That was really good. But something about worship, when we think about the connection, and there's a lot of different plans that went into the connection and about experiencing the presence of God, and there's something about worship that's different for different strokes for different folks, different looks for different folks. Sometimes it is the music. Sometimes, you know, people even now will ask us at both of our contemporary services, Riverside Campus, as River Street Campus, or here, why do we sing 7-11 songs? And if you don't know what that means, it means 7 words sung 11 times over and over. And they call them 7-11 songs. We call them praise and worship songs, but other people will say, you know, it's like 7 words sung 11 different stanzas of it or 11 different times. And some people say, I miss the, you know, the hymnal, or I miss the old hymns or the historic hymns, without using the word old hymns, because they're still precious and new, and we'll integrate those even here as we do at other places from time to time, and sometimes with just a little extra something added into them even. But worship is where we come and where we want to experience God. And for example, I just happen to keep seeing that Carl Hunsucker Sr., and it's supposed to say senior pastor, not just senior. Just kidding, guys. Passionate worship not only allows us to experience God, but the Psalm 100 passage simply said to us that we are to enter the Lord's gates, the Lord's presence, the presence of the Holy One of Israel is what they were talking about. We are to enter the gates of the compound, if you will, with thanksgiving and praise. Now, that sounds strange to us oftentimes, but not really, because I know I have it even on my way out here today, anticipating, you know, who is going to be here, what we were going to do, how we were going to present our music, the gospel, who's going to be in the parking lot. I knew I would be. I was wondering who else might be out there. Entering his gates, turning into the parking lot with thanksgiving and praise on our mind is exactly what the psalmist is talking about. As soon as the people would enter into the temple court, before they ever even entered into the temple, he's saying, hey, when you come before God in worship, come expecting to experience God, that God's going to do something wonderful, unique, and even maybe out of the norm that we experience in our lives, and that we will come with thanksgiving and praise that God is going to do something. What we normally do, or oftentimes, not normally, but oftentimes, we come into worship with great expectations and rules that we make up simply by saying, well, the music better be good, and this better be good, and that better be good, instead of coming in saying, Lord, speak to me today. Here I am. Speak to me. I come with open heart, open mind, open life, just like we open the doors of the church on Sunday morning and unlock them. God says, come into my presence with open heart, open mind, an open life, and give me praise and thanksgiving as you come into my life. We not only look at that, but come with thanksgiving and praise, and we come into God's presence expecting to experience God. But our third point that we'll share before we move into communion, passionate worship provides us with an opportunity to connect our faith and our life. Passionate worship changes us, not God. Passionate worship is about me meeting God, and because I've entered into his courts with thanksgiving and praise, I've had an experience with God that has changed my outlook on life. If you remember some time ago, 4 weeks ago actually, at our opening service, I used Zacchaeus as an example. Zacchaeus is in the Bible as that short guy that, if you remember, climbed up the sycamore tree that we read, or climbed up the tree to see Jesus as he passed by. And Jesus said to Zacchaeus, you come down, Zacchaeus. I'm going to your house today. And he did go to Zacchaeus' house. And when he did, if you remember that story, Zacchaeus connected his newfound faith and his life. There was a connection because he experienced God in that encounter, and he not only experienced God, the scripture says that he said with his heart full of joy that this is what I'm going to do now. I've had this experience with Jesus, in this encounter with Jesus, and I'm going to pay back anybody I've cheated 4 times what I stole from them. And I'm going to give half of everything I own to the poor. And that's what Zacchaeus said, because his faith and life were connected in a new way. And that's what happens to us when we are constantly involved in the worship setting and allowing ourselves to worship God in a powerful way. When we think about, that's what we want. We want worship that is meaning. We want worship that is life-changing. We want a church that can offer to people a time when you come on Sunday morning and you come anticipating and expecting that God's going to do something, because we're all connected in that common core, if you will, or home base. This is, as John mentioned last night to some of us, this could be like, I have a home base now that I meet. I have a sanctuary that I come into with a group of people on my team, and this is home base. This is where I hang out. This is where I come, and this is where I connect with others and connect with God. It doesn't mean I become instantaneously spiritual or some spiritual guru, but this is where I go for forgiveness and mercy and peace and empowerment, and this is where I try and give all that I can to experience God. A bishop in the Methodist Church, Bishop Robert Scanese, he mentions a passionate worship as one of the 5 keys to a vital congregation. I won't give you the other 4 right now, but they're around and we've used them for years. But his first one is that the church that is vital to a community has to have, work on, and offer passionate worship experiences for people. Let me explain his wording. This is what he wrote. Passionate worship cultivates our relationship with God and one another. Notice that word, cultivates our relationship with God and one another. Worship, passionate worship, transforms our lives. It heals our wounded souls. It renews hopes, shapes decisions, provokes change, inspires compassion, and binds people to one another with a common cause. In worship, God actively seeks a relationship with us, pardons our sin, and restores lives and changes us. Now that is a powerful definition of what passionate worship is. It sure beats coming out and just saying over and over in our lives, let's go get this over with. Come on now, y'all, lighten up. It sure beats sometimes telling our children, would you like to go to church today, or do y'all want to go to the lake? Or if you live near the beach as we did, we got that oftentimes when people would say, we could go to church or we could leave now and go on down to the beach. And which do the kids want to do? Passionate worship takes us into an understanding that God is important and that God is our priority in our lives. And that's what we want to experience in our lives. God working and moving in a powerful way. And as we worship together, we need to know that God is at the center of that worship time in our lives. And as we gather today, we have that opportunity to realize that in this moment of Holy Communion, we have this opportunity to experience the Lord in a renewed and powerful way. We have opportunity to give thanks and praise to God for what He's done, what He's doing, and what He's promised to do in the future in our lives and in our work and ministry together, not only here as a body of Christ at the Connection, but the body of Christ as a whole at St. Mark, period. And not only there, but with this bread and juice that the Holy Spirit uses to instruct us and uses to guide us to make Christ part of our daily living. We eat this bread and drink this cup, and Jesus basically tells us, I become part of you when you do this. And then as we think about that in daily living, I become part of you as you do this, and I become useful through your hands, through your feet, through your mouth, through your mind, through your lives. And that's what Jesus shares with us this morning. We have some words, again, of liturgy that are going to be coming up on the screen. And I'm going to probably read mine right off of this page because I have opportunity to face you as we do this. And what I'll do is simply let you know that part of what Bishop Scanese said just a moment ago is before us. When we come before a holy and righteous God and we look at the Scripture and remember all that they did when people encountered God, if you remember, Moses kicked his shoes off. Moses kicked his shoes off because he was standing on holy ground. And if you remember, the prophet Isaiah came before God, and there was a powerful move of God in his life, and Isaiah fell to the ground. And there's so many other times when people experience God in the Scripture that they had to renounce themselves as sinful people like Isaiah did. The great prophet Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 6, when he stood before God in that moment of encounter, he said, oh God, I am a man of unclean lips, and I am from a people who are unclean. And God touched his lips and brought healing and wholeness into his life. So one of the first things we do when we enter into this time of communion is that we confess our sin before God, and we ask God to cleanse us of this sin. So that liturgy, the first part, goes like this. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let's read together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet or still sinners. And that proves God's love toward us. So I announce and offer to you in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Those are powerful words. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. So at this point in our service, I would remind you that our Lord Jesus, on the night when he gave himself up for us, he was with his disciples in the upper room, and he knew that he was going to be going into Jerusalem and that he was going to be crucified on a cross. And he took a piece of bread that night and he did something unusual. They had broken bread many times together and shared in meals. But at the end of the meal, he took a piece of bread and he broke it and he presented it to his disciples. And he said, guys, I want you to take this and I want you to eat it. And he says, this is like my body that's going to be broken for you. And immediately it said, when the supper was over, he took the cup and he lifted it and presented it to them. And he said, I want you to take this cup and I want you to drink from it, because this cup, this wine, is like my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take and eat and drink this as often as you will, Jesus says, so you will remember me. And therefore, your faith is a part of your life, because our faith is in God and our faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ, and our faith is connected to our daily living when we realize that we too are a part of what Christ offers to the world, to share the good news. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, pour out your Holy Spirit to bear on these gifts of bread and wine. May they be for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. We pray in Christ's holy name. Amen. If those who are assisting would come forward, our ushers are going to direct you to come. We'll have two stations, one on each side of the room, and we'll also have some gluten-free bread right here in the middle that Lily is going to have, along with a different cup of the juice. So if you need gluten-free, you can have gluten-free bread to share. And you'll hear the body of Christ when you're handed a piece of bread, and you'll take the bread, dip it into the cup lightly, and just hear the words, the blood of Christ shed for you. I want to make sure that you know we have some refreshments in the fellowship hall and some conversation if you'd like to stay around and share, if you didn't get to do that prior, or if you just want to do it again. And also, some of the kids are still at Plugged in nursery, so make sure you take them home with you today. And I've asked Tim, come over here a minute, please, sir. Tim's going to share with you kind of a closing word about how God is moving in his life, but how God is moving through you, because many of you know this story, and he's just going to take a minute and share a blessing as we get ready to leave, and then I'll dismiss us. Thank you, Tim.
Many years ago, my daughter, Pamela, moved to Arizona, and we, because of a divorce, we fell out of favor, and I had referred to her many, many times as my prodigal daughter. She had unfriended me on Facebook back in 2012, and I was only able to keep in touch with what was going on in her life through a couple of my other daughters. About, I think it was the end of February last year, I went to a men's morning prayer breakfast, and I was given a book called Man in the Mirror. I don't read books, but I read that one, and it changed my appearance of myself and what I needed to do to be able to reach my daughter. Then at Ash Wednesday service last year, Chris Watts prayed a powerful prayer with me in front of the congregation as we were standing. About 4 days later, my daughter refriended me on Facebook. We started sharing more information through texts, but we had not spoken. On Sunday last week, my daughter called me. We spoke for 45 minutes, and neither one of us really wanted to hang up. It was such a reconnection that was really powerful. And it was because of prayer, me being able to pray her name each Sunday, sometimes to myself, sometimes out loud. It was because of the prayer of the congregation and the other friends and family that we had that has come. I might not see her for another year, I'm not sure. She has an immune deficiency. She cannot travel. She can't get out in public because catching a cold could kill her. Arizona is many, many miles away. I have a 10-year-old grandson that I've not seen yet. There's still lots of room for growth, but she has reconnected with me, and through me, she will reconnect with God. And I ask that your continued prayers and blessing be on my family. Thank you.
Thank you, brother.
I wanted to make sure that we left with that upbeat word, and we'll continue to pray for anyone. The interesting that has difficulty in their life, and as you leave today, know that our prayer room is right here, and there's someone in there that'll be in the prayer room waiting to pray with you. If you have a need or something you just would like to share with someone in the room, you can grab me after the service. I'll be glad to pray with you as well. And remember, sometimes people confuse the word religion, and we make up all types of things that God doesn't want us to have religion. He wants us to have relationship. But the word religion can get out of hand at times. But the word religion comes from two Greek words. One is re, literally, which means to join or rejoin, and ligio, which is like a ligament in your leg or your arm. And the word religion comes from those two words placed together, religio. Religio is the actual Greek word. And it means to rejoin that which is separated. And I think about Tim and his daughter and Tim's relationship with the Lord, which in many forms and fashion is his religion. And he's been religioed right there. And that's what God does for us through the Lord Jesus Christ. He reconnects us. He reties us. He rejoins us in that relationship with God. So keep that in mind. Let's all stand together. You can go ahead. I'm going to send you forth with this blessing. As you go forth, may you know and experience the grace, mercy, and peace of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit at work in your life now and forever. Amen. Amen. Amen.